Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Mosquito, the story of man's deadliest foe, by Andrew Spielman and Michael D'Antonio, narrated by Michael Butler Murray. If you would see all of nature gathered up at one point, in all her loveliness, and her skill, and her deadliness, and her sex, where would you find a more exquisite symbol than the mosquito? Havelock Ellis, 1920. Preface. The Trouble with Mosquitoes. It is the kind of everyday event that in the wrong place and time becomes unnerving. You are on vacation. Perhaps you are strolling at dusk along Fifth Avenue in New York. Maybe you've been taking pictures in the bush in Kenya. Or you are stepping off a ferry in Hong Kong. In a quiet moment, you feel the itch behind your knee. You reach down and touch a hot, raised welt. A mosquito bite. And you wonder, do mosquitoes in this place carry disease? Is an outbreak underway? What are the odds that the particular mosquito that drained my blood left something deadly behind? The mere fact that we ask these questions demonstrates the power of the mosquito. No animal on earth has touched so directly and profoundly the lives of so many human beings. For all of history, and all over the globe, she has been a nuisance, a pain, and an angel of death. Mosquitoes have felled great leaders, decimated armies, and decided the fates of nations. All this, and she is roughly the size and weight of a grape seed. At the dawn of the 21st century, the mosquito and the pathogens she transmits command attention worldwide. Each year, millions die from mosquito-borne malaria. National economies are locked in isolation as a result, in part of the same disease. Cities in Europe and the United States battle outbreaks of West Nile virus. Dozens of countries fight yellow fever, dengue, filariasis, and a host of deadly encephalitis viruses. To meet the health threats that are growing worse in many corners of the world, we must know the mosquito and see clearly her place in nature. More important, we should understand many aspects of our relationship to this tiny, ubiquitous insect and appreciate our long historical struggle to share this planet. When I was a college student in the early 1950s, nothing held more drama than the fight to save the world from the diseases that these creatures carried. The entomologists, parasitologists, and physicians in this corner of science conducted fascinating experiments in the lab. Some traveled to exotic, even dangerous places in brave crusades to save lives. They hacked through jungles, paddled up croc-infested streams, braved contact with hostile peoples, all in service to humanity. I was not the only undergrad at Colorado College to have this interest. An older student who lived across the hallway in my dorm shared my delight with this field. Every day, Phil Longnecker seemed to announce something fascinating and a little grotesque that he had read somewhere or other. A classic example: the way mosquitoes serve botflies in Central and South America. The size of a bumblebee, the fly seizes a mosquito in midair and glues her own eggs to her captive's abdomen. Later, when the mosquito feeds on a person, the damp warmth of human skin causes the fly's eggs to hatch, leaving maggots to burrow into the new host. Soon, the maggot's breathing apparatus can be seen poking through the victim's skin. Within a week, it's as large as a small olive. In 1951, I accompanied one of my professors on a train trip to Chicago to attend the organizational meeting of the American Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene, an annual event that brings together specialists in tropical medicine from all over the world. The conference would mark the moment when a young man who grew up fascinated by the natural world became dedicated to entomology and public health. I listened for 5 days as intensely bright and confident men gave talks on parasites and on mosquitoes in the Americas, Africa, and Asia. A keynote speaker described the valiant effort that defeated yellow fever so that the Panama Canal might be built. Stooped and aged, Joseph LePrince, sanitary engineer, seemed to me as though he were 1,000 years old. But though his voice creaked, his tale was spellbinding, filled with heroism in the face of great danger. Before the mosquito fighters prevailed, earth movers were silenced as armies of men languished in hospitals, and coffins lined the platforms at railway stations. The mosquito men I met at that meeting, at the time they were all men, seemed intelligent and incredibly daring. I wanted to be one of them. Advanced study at the Johns Hopkins School of Hygiene and Public Health and a tour of duty in the United States Navy led to a professorship at Harvard. In my time, I have felt both the thrill of discovery and felt the pangs of failure. But after 50 years, the work continues to bring endless challenges and surprises. The truth of a career in entomology and tropical public health turned out to be as exciting to me as its anticipation. Though I could never approach the heights scaled by such pioneers as Patrick Manson, Ronald Ross, and Walter Reed, I shared in their adventure during a time when everything in science seemed possible. It may be difficult to love the mosquito, but anyone who comes to know her well develops a deep appreciation. A few species, like the iridescent blue-lined Uranitania saffarina, are truly beautiful. All manifest exquisite adaptation to their environment. As a larva, the mosquito feeds and navigates in water. As an adult, she walks on water as well as land. She flies through the night air with the aid of the stars. She not only sees and smells, but also senses heat from a distance. Lacking our kind of a brain, she nevertheless thinks with her skin, changing direction, and fleeing danger in response to myriad changes in her surroundings. More than most other living things, the mosquito is a self-serving creature. She doesn't aerate the soil like ants and worms. She is not an important pollinator of plants like the bee. She does not even serve as an essential food item for some other animal. She has no purpose other than to perpetuate her species. That the mosquito plagues human beings is really, to her, incidental. She is simply surviving and reproducing. The first part of this book is concerned with the life of the mosquito. It explores her world with all its dangers, and it examines her adaptation to different environments, including those special niches where mosquitoes and people come together. The second part of this book addresses the mosquito's intimate relationship with human beings. It is remarkable that centuries ago, a few bright minds actually guessed that there was a connection between mosquitoes and diseases, such as malaria and yellow fever. But this concept was so fantastic to the mainstream of science at the time that it was dismissed. As recently as 1870, the idea that a mosquito might kill was considered preposterous. The breakthrough discoveries of the mosquito's deadly qualities were shocking to the general public. They led immediately to an era of ferocious scientific competition. What was learned changed our understanding of disease and altered the course of history. In its final section, this book turns to the modern era, which has understood the dangers posed by mosquitoes and tried to confront them. Much progress has been made. We now have effective therapies for many mosquito-borne diseases, and we have workable methods for confronting mosquitoes in the environment. Nevertheless, this insect and the pathogens that it carries have proven to be hardy, clever, and relentless. Today, despite all our technology and science, mosquitoes may pose a risk to health virtually anywhere in the world. In fact, our troubles with mosquitoes are getting worse, making more people sick and claiming more lives, millions of lives, every year. Drug-resistant malaria plagues the tropics, and many regions that were once considered fully cleansed of mosquito-borne pathogens have recently begun to suffer these plagues once again. Part 1. Magnificent Enemy. 1. The Mosquito Herself. Consider the most common mosquito on Earth, one that is likely resting in some dark corner of your very own home. Or if you are listening to this in bed on a warm summer evening, about to issue its faint buzz, do you hear it right now? In your ear. This soft, dusty brown insect with a body less than a quarter inch long is probably Culex pipiens, one of more than 2,500 different species of mosquitoes. You've seen her land on your arm. You have caught her just at the end of feeding, her translucent belly swelling red with your blood. At such a moment, you can be forgiven for failing to notice what an elegant and hardy thing she is. But she is. I have encountered Culex, the common house mosquito, in every corner of the world. In one village in Africa, I watched in amazement as thousands coated the walls of a hut, making the surface seem like a living carpet. I have found her beneath the courtyard at Harvard Medical School, in the Paris Metro, and in the gaudy Ginza shopping district in Tokyo. The most impressive infestation I ever saw was at the graveyard of Confucius in China. The stone-lined graves in the cemetery are cracked and filled with water. They are perfect breeding places for Culex, which become so numerous at times, they look like smoke in the air. Visitors have to cover their mouths to avoid inhaling them with each breath. Whether she is African, Asian, European, or American, the common house mosquito begins life in essentially the same way, as a tiny egg attached to hundreds of others, which make up a tapered black raft that resembles a half grain of rice floating in still water. As a young scientist, I recorded how the female Culex pipiens creates this little boat, complete with a pointed bow as she lays and fertilizes her eggs. My observations were made in a lab, where I had used a glass tube with a screen and a rubber hose to inhale a gravid female and deposit her in a test tube filled with water. I then sat, transfixed, for the 15 minutes she needed to complete her maternal task. She starts by lighting on the water, crossing her hind legs, and lowering her abdomen. One by one, her eggs are extruded. She twitches so that each one is turned head down and placed upright between her legs. Slowly, she stacks the eggs, one after another, between her legs. As the eggs move outward into the water, her legs spread to form a little craft with a wide beam and a pointed bow. In the end, approximately 240 eggs float together in the shape of a tiny abandoned canoe. Though I was among the first to record the construction of a Culex egg raft, I was not the first to witness mosquito egg laying. Here, the renowned malariologist Paul Russell was a pioneer. Decades before my observations, he and an assistant had crept along the embankment of a rice paddy in India to witness an Anopheles coulissifacies, a species that carries malaria there, giving birth to eggs that she laid in the water, not in a raft, one by one. Russell and his companion had accomplished their scientific mission with the help of a shiny spoon attached to a stick, which, once placed over the water, seemed to attract the mother mosquito, who then began ovipositing in flight, like a tiny dive bomber. Secure in the raft, each Culex pipiens mosquito embryo develops with its head down, resting against a line of fracture encircling its shell. The entire incubation process takes just 2 days, and at the end, often nearly in unison, the grayish-white larvae burst outward by the hundreds. They emerge as long, segmented, wriggling larvae with whiskered heads that hang down in the water for feeding and tails equipped with a breathing tube that takes in air at the surface of the water. All of the world's insects, as well as all arthropods, including crabs and lobsters, are descended from a single segmented ancestor, a wormish creature called an onychophoran. Onychophora, which still crawl the planet today, are made of more than a dozen similar segments, each with a pair of stubby legs. An onychophoran possess a mouth, which is always open, a simple gut, and an anus at its terminal end. Though it is sometimes difficult to see, especially in crabs, all arthropods share onychophora's segmentation. It is quite evident in a mosquito larva, which has a worm-like abdomen but is also equipped with a thorax and a well-formed head with eyes and an elaborate mouth. The mouth includes a pair of mandibles for chewing, a pair of laterally mounted maxillae for grasping, and upper and lower lips, known as the labrum and the labium. Beyond the head, three segments of the larva's thorax are ornamented with hairs, which the larva uses to stabilize itself in the water. The terminal group of segments bears the air tube, or siphon, through which it breathes. Nearly all larvae drift through life with this tube, located on their rears, poking up against the surface of the water where it can take in air. If Culex pipiens and all the other mosquitoes never developed beyond the larval stage, they would still be beautiful and fascinating animals. To the naked eye, they seem to float peacefully, their bodies hanging down from the very surface of the water. Under magnification, they can appear as fierce as any monster in an outer space movie, with large eyes, spiky whiskers, and hungry mouths. Among the thousands of species of mosquito that have been named, there are many variations on this beginning to life. One, Wyomia smithii, will develop only in the water that collects in North American pitcher plants. In the same bogs where the pitcher plants grow, a mosquito called Coccolitidia perturbans has a truly bizarre way of finding its air supply. At birth, the larva of this mosquito swims backward, pressing its siphon against the roots of cattail plants. From the end of the siphon, it extends first a kind of tweezer that opens a hole in the cattail root. It then inserts its breathing tube into the hole and uses a series of hook-like appendages to secure itself firmly in place. The siphon brings the larva air from chambers inside the plant's roots. Mosquitoes are like nesting dolls. At every stage in their development, they already contain the beginnings of organs and muscles they will require in the next. So when the larva begins to evolve into the pupa, it already has inside it all the pupa's organs. Similarly, the pupa will contain every organ of the flying adult. The insect within an insect phenomenon was observed in the 1920s by one of the grand men of mosquito science, Sir Richard Christophers. Christophers was a classical scientist who worked well past his 100th birthday. Along with his many discoveries, he is remembered for a letter he wrote to the American Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene, taking exception to the publication of his obituary. As the Culex larva reaches about 10 days of age, the pupil eye becomes visible as a crescent forming around the round larval eye. Other pupil organs also form, but beyond view, unless we use special techniques. When the larva is about 12 days old, an enzyme begins the process that will lead to the shedding of its outer covering, or cuticle. Slowly, air is taken into the space that separates the old larval cuticle and the pupa's own cuticle, which is forming beneath it. Eventually, a split develops right down the middle of the thorax. The pupa emerges through this slit, and the old skin of the larva floats away. With eyes but no mouth, the pupa appears to be totally different from the larva. It breathes through a pair of tubes called respiratory trumpets that are located on the thorax and that will replace the larva's single siphon. At first, its cuticle is soft. But in the course of an hour, the cuticle hardens, the abdomen shrinks, and the pupa's body curves into the shape of a comma. Though they don't feed, the waterborne pupae do not just linger in repose. They are mobile creatures with large eyes that are extremely sensitive to a sudden shadow moving over them. If disturbed, they flip their tails and tumble out of harm's way and then rise again to the surface to breathe. Our little female house mosquito will spend just 2 days in the pupal stage, undergoing her transformation from wriggling water creature to flying bloodsucker. If the temperature and other conditions are just right, she will rapidly develop her adult nervous system, muscles, limbs, mouthparts, and other organs. In the final hours of its development, perhaps in the leaf-clogged rain gutter of your house, or in the forgotten wading pool down the street, the pupa begins the final drama of its brief existence. Right up to the last 10 minutes, it retains the ability to flip its tail in pupal fashion and tumble in spurts, like a miniature cannonball. But eventually this movement stops. The pupa stretches its length under the water's surface. The insect inside begins to fill the pupil covering with air until the pressure makes it split open. Slowly the new adult, called the imago, emerges. The back of her thorax comes first, followed by wings, body, legs. Soft and wobbly, she pulls herself up and walks gently on the water. After about a half hour, her cuticle stiffens, and she flies away to find a quiet place, protected from wind, rain, and harsh sunlight, where she can rest and complete her development to maturity. In flight, a culex female's wings will beat between 250 and 500 times per second. The veins that run along the long axis of each wing provide stiffness while allowing for flex, which increases the flow of air. Muscles at the wing's base help it to bow with each stroke, adding to its lifting properties. The whole structure permits a mosquito to fly at speeds of up to 3 miles per hour, and also to hover, though a bit clumsily. All of this flying skill comes in handy whether she is pursuing a blood meal or approaching a mate. The exquisite emergence of a newly adult mosquito takes place billions of times each day, all over the world. Mosquitoes live 8,000 feet up in the Himalayas and below sea level in the California desert. The eggs of one extremely adaptable mosquito can survive decades of drought in the Sahara until a brief rainfall permits a hatch. These mosquitoes may hatch already laden by their mother with a virus that can be transmitted to humans, which is one reason that rain in the desert can be a terrible thing. Above the Arctic Circle, herds of caribou will migrate long distances to avoid the bite of Ocleritatus communis. This mosquito is so aggressive that it feeds on the still warm blood of recently deceased animals. Although the blood meal, or to be more graphic, the feast on human blood, is the one act that we all associate with mosquitoes, it is actually something that the vast majority of mosquitoes will never enjoy. Only a minority of species will deign to feed on human blood, and many of these will turn to other sources as well. And, as is well known, only half of the members of these species, the female half, will practice vampirism at all. What few people understand is that the one mosquito out of a million that bites a particular ankle is not partaking in an ordinary meal. For the most part, mosquitoes, like butterflies, feed on nectar or other sources of sugar, such as rotting fruit. Some species will feed on the honeydew excreted by other insects, and one in Asia will actually descend upon a certain kind of ant, insert her proboscis in the remarkably cooperative ant's mouth, and suck out regurgitated nutrients. Nearly all female mosquitoes ingest blood mainly to fuel the production of eggs. But we are getting a bit ahead. Well before she exploits her blood to do her reproductive duty, Culex pipiens will have to be impregnated. Generally, neither the male nor the female mosquito is prepared for sex immediately after emerging from the pupal covering. A shocking exception to this rule is an exotic mosquito in New Zealand called Apophex fuscus, which develops in pools of salt water along the coast. In this breed, rapacious males stake out the watery places where mosquito pupae are present. As the pupae begin to open, the males will skim across the water like submarine hunting aircraft. When a pupa rises to break the surface of the water, the male races to the spot. He seizes the pupa, and the force of his attack can cause it to split open. The mosquito inside is helpless because his or her legs have not yet freed themselves. If the emergent mosquito is a male, the marauder lets go. If it is a female, an event that is essentially a rape ensues, with the male assuring that the female is impregnated in its first moment of adult life. Among the common house mosquitoes, sex is not quite so violent and dramatic. Culex females emerge on their own accord, unmolested, and rest for a few hours to complete maturing after escaping the pupal case. This is an unremarkable process, like tidying up what has already begun. In comparison, the newborn male's situation is downright ridiculous. As he emerges from the cuticle, his sex organs are on the wrong side of his body, and he must wait nearly a day for the terminal segments of his abdomen to rotate around so that everything is aimed in the right direction. At that time, he will use his antennae, which are fuzzier, more sensitive instruments than hers, to detect the whining sound of a female's wing beat. The wing tone of immature males of less than 2 days' age is quite similar to a female's, which results in some rather unsuccessful encounters among sexually eager fellow males. The sounds made by mosquitoes have been studied extensively. Researchers have found that while one kind of mosquito generally ignores the tone of another, the males and the females of the same species are profoundly responsive to the tones of their mates. A well-known story of the powerful attraction the female's sound holds for males involves a power station built in Canada. It malfunctioned repeatedly until engineers discovered that the equipment was being gummed up by thousands of mosquitoes, all males, apparently attracted by the sound the machinery produced. Once they are about 2 days old, Culex males and females are mature enough to mate. The process begins at dusk or dawn, with scores or even hundreds of males forming a dance swarm in the air near a landmark called a swarm marker, such as the chimney of a house or a church steeple. Some species of mosquito will swarm over an animal or even a person walking in their range. Though how they choose a marker is not fully understood, the height of an object or the movement, heat, and scent of an animal may be involved. The Culex swarm can be so thick that it might be mistaken for smoke. In many species, generation after generation will swarm in the same location year after year. This is not because some important bit of information is mysteriously transferred along the bloodlines, but rather because the insects are programmed by nature to perform this way, and males born near the swarm marker will invariably be drawn to it. Just as the males seek the marker, females will be drawn to the swirling mass of males and fly into it one by one. Often several males will be drawn to a female, but only one will take hold securely enough to remain with her once they've glided to the ground. Upon landing, the young male crawls beneath the female, and the act can begin. In the most successful encounters, the pair may be so tightly locked together that the male has some difficulty escaping in the end. An unfortunate few males manage to get away only by leaving their sex organs behind. The male also leaves behind in his semen a pheromone called matrone that renders the female much less receptive to future sexual partners. Indeed, it's likely that one sexual encounter is all she'll experience, but males may mate 7 or 8 times. As cold, even brutal as mosquito sex may seem, it is downright romantic compared with the mating behaviors of sea worms, another creature that mates by swarming. One summer night at Woods Hole in Massachusetts, Rachel Carson, the famous author ecologist, brought me and other students to the end of a small dock at the Marine Biological Laboratory, where she shined a light in the water. A couple dozen male sea worms swam to the illuminated spot and began to circle in their own swarm. When a female entered the swirl, a male responded by entwining himself around her, plunging his tail down her mouth, and depositing his sperm into her gut. And then came the most surprising action of all. The female burst, releasing the eggs and sperm and thereby giving her life for her progeny. Compared with the female sea worms, female Culex pipiens fare quite well. After a sexual encounter, the males fly away with the chance to mate again. For the female, a single minute or so of passion allows her to produce all the fertile eggs she will ever lay. This is because she stores sperm in her own body and dispenses them to fertilize her eggs as they are laid. Thus supplied, she needs just one more ingredient, blood, to nourish the eggs. Though blood is vital to reproduction for most mosquitoes, nature is almost infinite in her variety, which means that we can make very few absolute declarations about mosquitoes. The fact is, a few kinds of mosquitoes are autogynous, meaning they can lay fertile eggs without blood. An even more surprising fact is that some males have been seen sucking human blood. These extremely unusual mosquitoes are gynandromorphs, males that also exhibit some female markings. The gender confusion probably compels them to feed, though they have no use for the blood. Blood-sucking female mosquitoes of various species search for meals at characteristic times of the day. Aedes aegypti, a mosquito that transmits dengue fever from Texas to Argentina, prefers to feed at dusk. The common house mosquito will come out to feed after dark. Other types are most active at midday. You can get a sense of a mosquito's behavior and response to stimuli by imagining how she sees you during blood feeding. You are standing on a small hill, flapping your arms to ward away the mosquitoes that you sense are buzzing your way. As you swat and flail, the effort increases the carbon dioxide and lactic acid you exhale with each breath. This is good for many mosquitoes, because sensors on their antennae are tuned to these chemicals and others coming from your body. Your scent plume, which is heavier than air, sinks toward the ground. The mosquito flies low to intersect the plume at its widest part, using her two extended antennae to orient herself in the odor gradient. But the increase in scent is only one way that you are aiding the enemy. As the mosquito approaches, your waving arms will help stimulate the vision sensors in one or both of her compound eyes. Like a housefly, a mosquito has eyes that are made of hundreds of tubes, each capped with a fixed lens. Called ommatidia, each points outward at a different angle. The lenses of the tube do not focus, so they present an infinite image onto the rhabdom, which is a long photosensitive filament in the center of each ommatidium. Each adjacent large and overlapping ommatidium sees a part of the visual field in full depth. If we had eyes such as these, there wouldn't be enough neurons in our brains to convert so many images into a picture. Mosquitoes haven't a chance of doing it either. Instead, they use their eyes to orient themselves on a fixed point. At night, they can locate distant sources of light such as the moon or even stars, and fly straight by keeping those lights in a constant bearing. The mosquito who pursues you follows the same strategy, moving to keep all those lenses properly lined up on the point in space you represent. No matter how you move, she adjusts her flight to keep you fixed in her field of vision. So there you are, on this hilltop, waving your arms trying to keep the mosquitoes away, and everything you do is working against you. Your scent tickles the mosquito's antennae. Your movement catches her eyes. Finally, as she gets closer, the heat generated by your flailing muscles guides her to the most radiant spot on your body, that bit of flesh not covered by clothing, and your blood. The mosquito will alight so softly that you may not notice her at all. Before actually feeding, she'll probe your skin as many as 20 times, like a blind phlebotomist who can taste blood with the end of his needle. The probing will be accomplished by a proboscis that is much more than the simple needle most of us imagine it to be. In fact, the proboscis of the female mosquito is much more like the complex devices surgeons snake through a body to perform remote control surgery. The business part of the proboscis consists of two tubes surrounded by two pairs of cutting stylets that stick together in a tight bundle. Together they are called the fascicle. The fascicle lies in a gutter-shaped sheath called the labium, or lip. When the mosquito lands on the cutaneous oasis from which she'll drink, she applies this apparatus against the skin. With a bit of pressure, the labium bends back toward her body as the cutting edges, stylets, of her fascicle break the surface of the skin. To do this, the stylets slide against each other and split the skin like a pair of electric carving knives. Once below the surface, the fascicle bends at a sharp angle to begin exploring for blood. With each insertion, the mosquito attempts to nick a venule or arteriole, vessels much larger than a capillary, and promote the flow of blood. If she doesn't succeed with the first try, she will withdraw the fascicle slightly while leaving it in the original hole and angle it in a different direction, With each insertion, the fine salivary tube in her fascicle will deliver a chemical that inhibits your body's ability to stop any bleeding that might begin. Once a mosquito tastes blood, she holds very still, and her sucking pulls the blood venule over her mouth parts. In 90 seconds' time, she will suck a few micrograms of red fluid, 2 or 3 times her weight, up into her stomach. She will stop her feeding when stretch receptors in her belly signal her nervous system that she is full. After she finishes her meal and she is heavy with the red liquid, a female mosquito must struggle to become airborne. In flight, she is a slow target for a swatting hand. But if she escapes, she generally will land on the nearest vertical surface, a wall, a tree, or perhaps a post on a front porch. There she will rest and perform one of the most notable feats of digestion in nature. For 45 minutes or more, the mosquito will allow her digestive system to draw water out of the precious blood she has stolen and excrete it in the form of urine. If you happen across a mosquito in the middle of this process, you will likely see the pinkish droplets coming out of her anus. Only after her meal has been processed into lighter solids that are stored for the future will the female mosquito fly away with the stuff to make her offspring. What she leaves behind in the saliva that was pumped into your skin might irritate you, or if your luck is very bad, kill you. 2. An insect's world. Darting against the blue sky, 100 feet above the ground, the spotted flycatcher might see nothing more than a flash of reflected sunlight, a shining mirror in the grass below her. As the bird flits lower, the light becomes a pool of polluted water that fills a clogged drainage ditch. She lands on a branch just above the pool's edge. Though clouded by the droppings of cattle and rotting vegetation, the still water gains her attention. She hops down to take a drink. Countless puddles like this form along the banks of the lower Nile River, all the way south to the Aswan Dam. Completed in 1968, the huge dam, which is visible to astronauts orbiting Earth, ended the annual cycle of flooding and receding waters that had plagued Nile River peoples for all of time. It created cheap and abundant electricity. It brought reliable water supplies to more than 1 million acres of farmland. And it allowed millions of people to settle deeper into the wadis, shallow valleys where ground now remains perpetually sodden. The dam improved life immeasurably for local mosquitoes. It created thousands of wet places that produce a harvest of pests as abundant as any other crop in this intensely fertile region. Millions of Culex pipiens emerge from these hatcheries every day. They needn't fly far to find convenient sources of blood. It's right there, in nearby farmhouses and apartment buildings. And once the meal is consumed, it's a short jaunt back to the warm, ever-present breeding puddle. These tropical Culex pipiens focus on human hosts. When it visits the Nile puddle, the flycatcher might notice a few black specks about the size of caraway seeds floating on this murky puddle. But these are not seeds. These specks are mosquito egg rafts. There is no reason for the bird to remain, so she flits away. As she leaves, one of those seemingly inert floating specks suddenly comes to life as hundreds of tiny wrigglers descend from its lower surface. What stimulates larval mosquitoes to hatch from their eggs? In many species, especially those that live in more transient waters, the environment offers the hatching cue. Their eggs wait for months, or even years, in desert, frozen tundra, drying flower vases, or discarded chamber pots. The eggs hatch only when their surroundings become flooded, and the water reduces the amount of oxygen available to each egg. For the eggs of Egyptian Culex mosquitoes, the hatching stimulus is an internal series of chemical signals that flow as the embryo matures. These eggs do not rest in a suspended state. They begin to mature as soon as they are laid in water, and they hatch quickly. Hatching is a dramatic affair. From just below the water's surface, the egg rafts would seem to be sprouting hundreds of tiny hairs. After a bit of wiggling around, Each larva breaks free of the structure. At first, they descend an inch or two deeper, almost to the mucky bottom of the puddle. But seconds later, they bob to the surface and orient their tails upward as they reach for air. Before your anthropomorphic imagination runs amok with images of the Titanic's survivors struggling to breathe in the freezing Atlantic, remember that these larval mosquitoes are born fully adapted to their environment. If all goes normally, each of these just-hatched larvae will simply float, back end up, until its breathing tube breaks the water's surface. A circlet of valves at the tip keeps the tube safely closed until it meets the air, and respiration begins. Although these larvae will immediately be at home in the water, they do face challenges to their survival. In their first few minutes of life, each must empty the water that fills its tracheolar breathing system and inflate it with air. This network of tubules serves the insect as its lungs. Air diffuses throughout the tracheolar tree, moving passively from the tiny valved pore at the end of the larva's breathing tube and throughout its body. The good news for the larvae in this puddle is that no fish are present to gulp them down. This is one advantage of the house mosquito's tendency to breed in filthy standing water. Other kinds of mosquitoes, which are born from eggs laid at the edges of streams or lakes, must cope with many different kinds of fish. A brood can be rapidly decimated by these voracious creatures. The survivors hide where emergent vegetation creates a complex interface between liquid, solid, and air. Ecologists use the term intersection line to describe the suitability of such long-standing waters as breeding sites for mosquitoes. Snug in their puddles of dirty water, Culex pipiens also escape the fate of being eaten alive by other mosquitoes. The wrigglers of Aedes aegypti and others born from eggs laid in tree holes and in man-made containers such as tires are hunted and consumed by the cannibalistic larvae of Toxorhynchites, the largest mosquitoes of all. Toxorhynchites feed only on other mosquito larvae that happen to share its breeding site. They are so vicious that once they wipe out all their cousins, some turn on their own brothers and sisters. In the end, they kill just for the sake of killing, letting the uneaten bodies drift away. Often the attacks go on until just a single larva remains. The Culex larvae in our Nile Delta puddle must begin to eat in order to fuel the growth that will lead them to more than triple their size in about a week's time. This requires a huge amount of food and, as a result, almost constant effort. With their tail end breathing tubes at the surface of the water, the head-down larval mosquitoes rhythmically wave the rake-like arrays of prominent hairs that surround their mouths. Just as a butterfly's wings create a whispery current of air, the larva's whiskers make a current in the water. This self-made current delivers a never-ending meal to the larva's mouth. The banquet is mainly comprised of microorganisms, the very same animals and plants that you would see if you placed a drop of this puddle water on a slide and looked at it through a microscope.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.